really sorry. Like I say, you'd think this was my first day. You know, several years ago here at Shelby CC, we did a little sermon series entitled, We Are United in Jesus Christ. And we used a theme song at that time through the series by the Brooklyn Tabernacle Choir by the same name, that we are united in Jesus Christ. And the words went something like this. Let me just read it to you. We are united in Jesus Christ. We are the soldiers of the light. We don't wrestle flesh and blood, but principalities of the dark. We do our marching to one beat, crushing the enemy under our feet. We are mighty in our stand, with God's word in our hand. In our hearts we have a vision. We have made our decision to show the Father's love with great power from above. Let us reach this generation, every tribe, every nation, for we've overcome the world by the blood of Christ the Lamb. The Lord our God is a sword and shield. We fight our battles on our knees. We are united in Jesus Christ. We are soldiers of the light. We don't wrestle flesh and blood, but principalities of the dark. We do our marching in one beat, crushing the enemy under our feet. We are mighty in our stand, with God's word in our hand. That's a powerful song. There's a lot of words there. There's a lot of meaning for the church. And, you know, as a church body, we still are soldiers today. We're soldiers for the cross. We're soldiers for Christ. And, you know, every week our mission statement appears on the back of our bulletin. It's not changed in 20 years. And you might flip your bulletin and look at that. I'm going to read it to you. I think we've got it on the screen. Shelby Christian Church is a family committed to worshiping God, growing in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We're reaching the lost with the life-saving message of Jesus Christ and using the Bible as our only rule of faith. We gather to worship, to study God's word, to encourage one another, and reach out to our community and beyond with the love of Christ. And you know, all those things are true, and that's a good statement for Shelby Christian Church. That's a good soldier training and a good commitment. You know, the past several weeks, we've been talking about God calling Abraham out of the land of Ur, and God began to form a nation of God's people. Through our studies, we've learned that we are a part of that people, the church. We, as followers of Jesus Christ, we are a part of that people, followers of Christ. We're God's people today, the same people that began all those many years ago when God called Abraham out of Ur of the Chaldeans, all made possible through Jesus Christ our Lord. And you know, the scripture tells us all the way throughout the scripture, the Bible, it is stated that Jesus Christ was with God from the very beginning of time. I believe everything happened for a purpose and for a reason, and it was all in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. And you know, God throughout the ages has committed to shape and to form his people into the people that he wants them to be. The church, we are that people. We're blessed to be a blessing, as we've studied that. Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 3, the covenant made with Abraham. That we are blessed to be a blessing. God was going to make him into a large nation. The members would be more numerous than the stars in the sky, the sand on the seashore. And of course, again, we are all a part of God's people. We're a part of that covenant. So last week we talked about how by God's providence, his people were led to Egypt, where they could grow into a large nation without being influenced by pagan gods. Why? Because Egypt did not attempt to teach their religious practices to God's people. I mean, Pharaoh was content just to have slaves. He really wasn't interested in teaching the people of God about his gods, if you will. But you know, there were several unifying factors that allowed God's people to become the mighty nation that they became. And so today we want to look at those factors that helped to mold Israel into a people in pursuit of a common purpose. It's the same purpose that we are in pursuit of even today. Now, the first unifying factor, if you have your outlines out, would be the rite of circumcision. The rite of circumcision. Please turn with me, if you would, please, to Genesis 17. You can put a bookmark in Colossians there, Paul's letter to the church of Colossae. But if you go just to the first book of the Bible, Genesis chapter 17. And what I'd like for us to look at in Genesis 17, let's begin in verse 1 and read 1 through 13. Reading from the word of our Lord. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to him and said, I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless. I will confirm my covenant between me and you and will greatly increase your numbers. Abram fell face down, and God said to him, as for me, this is my covenant with you. You shall be the father of many nations. You see, God is just repeating this covenant. No longer will you be called Abram. Your name will be Abraham, for I have made you a father of many nations. I will make you very fruitful. I will make nations of you, and kings will come from you. I will establish my covenant as an everlasting covenant between me and you and your descendants after you for the generations to come, to be your God and the God of your descendants after you. The whole land of Canaan, where you are now an alien, I will give as an everlasting possession to you and your descendants after you, and I will be their God. Now, verse 9. Then God said to Abraham, as for you, you must keep my covenant and your descendants after you for the generations to come. This is my covenant with you and your descendants after you, the covenant you are to keep. Every male among you shall be circumcised. You are to undergo circumcision, and it will be the sign of the covenant between me and you. For the generations to come, every male among you who is 8 days old must be circumcised, including those born in the household or bought with money from a foreigner, those who are not your offspring, whether born in your household or bought with your money, they must be circumcised. My covenant in your flesh is to be an everlasting covenant. It was the rite of circumcision. You see, Israel might forget many things as a people, but God would not permit his people to forget that they had entered into a covenant with him. And if his people did have a lapse of memory concerning his place in their plan of blessing, then there was always going to be that mark on the flesh to refresh their memory. You see that once again in verse 11 as we reiterate, you are to undergo circumcision, and here it is, it will be a sign of the covenant between me and you. You see, historical memories that were worth retaining, like all the things that they had gone through up until this point, they were not filed away in Hebrew archives, much like what we might do today. They were not carried in Jewish portfolios, if you will. They were written upon the flesh of God's people. Look with me again at verse 13, chapter 17. Whether born in your household or bought with your money, they must be circumcised. My covenant in your flesh is to be an everlasting covenant. It will be an everlasting covenant. You see, it was through this rite of circumcision that Israel's place as God's people with the divine purpose was kept alive. It was something that they would remember day in and day out. I mean, tell me God is not an all-knowing God. He knew just what to do. Now, this united Israel as a people, and that's what we're talking about here this morning, that we're united for a destiny, which includes you and me. So God wrote this upon their heart. This united Israel wrote this on the flesh. The united Israel as a people in pursuit of a common purpose, a people that were blessed to be a blessing. Now, we are God's people, you and me, in pursuit of a common purpose, just as they were in the days of old. Please turn with me, if you would, please, now to Colossians. Colossians in the New Testament, Paul's letter to the church at Colossae. We're going to look at chapter 2 today. And we've got that same awareness as his followers today. Look with me, if you would, please, beginning in verse 9 of chapter 2 of Colossians. For in Christ, all the fullness of the deity lives in body form. And you have been given fullness in Christ, who is the head over every power and authority. Verse 11, in him you were also circumcised in the putting off of the sinful nature, not with the circumcision done by the hands of men, but with the circumcision done by Christ. Having been buried with him in baptism and raised with him through your faith in the power of God who raised him from the dead. Verse 13, when you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your sinful nature, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave us all our sins, having canceled the written code with its regulations that was against us and that stood opposed to us. He took it away, nailing it to the cross. What I'm talking about here for the Christian, it was a rite of circumcision of the heart because of Christian baptism. Did you see it there in our text? For in Christ, all the fullness of the deity, I mean, that is God, all the fullness of the deity, God, lives in bodily form. You may remember from Philippians chapter 2, verse 6, that Christ is in his very nature is God. Christ in his very nature is God. And so we see here in our text, for in Christ, all the fullness of the deity, all the fullness of God lives in bodily form. That's in Christ. God is fully God and fully man. Now, the word for deity is theotetos in Greek. It's a strong word. It's used here in the New Testament and only in the New Testament for Christ's essence as God. That's exactly what it means. It's the essence of God, the deity. Christ in his very nature is God. Now, what does that mean to you and me? What does it mean to the followers of Christ? In Christ, our text says, we have been brought to the fullness. You see, just as the Shekinah glory, that is God's glory, filled the tabernacle and the temple, the perfections of God the Father fill the Son, Jesus, the Messiah. He lacks no part of God. Remember, Christ is God's very image. But I want you to hear this, because this is even more remarkable. Verse 10 talks about he who embodies the fullness of God fills us. I mean, that's what our text says here in verse 10. And you have been given fullness in Christ, that is, Christ's followers have been given fullness in Christ, who is the head over every power and authority. So you see, the only way for sinners to be filled by the fullness of God is to be joined to Christ through our acceptance of him and what he has done for us, to be incorporated into the body of which he is the head, and that is the church. So how do we do that? Well, once again, let's go back to verses 11 and 12. In him, you were also circumcised in the putting off of the sinful nature, not with the circumcision done by the hands of man, but with the circumcision done by Christ. And here it is, having been buried with him in baptism and raised with him through your faith in the power of God who raised him from the dead. I mean, how awesome is that? We receive the fullness of Christ when we accept Christ and all that he has done for us, and we accept him through our Christian baptism, where we're raised to a newness of life. You know, the Gnostics of Paul's day challenged both Christ's deity and his humanity. These were guys who thought that they were all-knowing. Those heretics, they diminished Christ to an angel whose body was only apparent but not real. This was their teaching. Well, the Apostle Paul affirmed here in this letter to the church at Colossae that Christ is both fully God and fully man. You know, last week we talked about separation being a uniting factor, and I'm going to simply touch on that again this week. Separation is another uniting factor, and that's why I wanted to mention that again this week. You see, through Christ, and though Christ said that we are in the world, but we are not of the world, John chapter 17, it still does us good to live in the world, but differently than the world all the time. We are to live differently all the time than the way the world lives. At the same time, it does us well to separate from the world from time to time. And we mentioned that last week. I mean, Hebrews chapter 10, verses 24 and 25, the writer of Hebrews said, "And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching." You see, it does us well to come together, much like we are this morning. We encourage one another, just coming together as a like people in faith. And then the things that we say to one another, the Sunday school classes that we attend, all that. You know, there was a story told about a man who opened the door to get his morning newspaper, but he was surprised to see a strange little dog with his paper in his mouth. And the man was delighted, of course, with this unexpected delivery service. So the man said, "You know, I went in the house and I found him a treat, and I gave him a treat." The man went on to say, "The following morning, I was horrified to see that same dog sitting in front of our door, wagging his tail, surrounded by 8 newspapers." He was encouraged by that little treat. And of course, the more newspapers, the more of a treat, surely. And the man went on to say that he spent the rest of the morning returning the papers to their respectful owners. You know, William Arthur Ward once said, "Flatter me and I may not believe you. Criticize me and I may not like you. Ignore me and I may not forgive you. But encourage me and I will not forget you. Encourage me and I will not forget you." My friends, we need encouragement as brothers and sisters in the Lord. And that's why the scripture says, "Do not forsake the coming together of one another, but all the more as the day," and that day is a capital D, talking about in the last days, which is from the time that Jesus came up until he comes again, are the last days. You see, it's biblical that we encourage one another. When we separate ourselves from the world to praise God with brothers and sisters in Christ, God uses the church, you and me, to encourage others within the church. And then we are much more able to go out and fulfill that great commission of bringing others to Christ. You see, when the people of God separated themselves from the pagans who were worshiping other gods, then they begin to hear God's voice. Now, not audibly, but through the Spirit, they were able to hear God's voice. And you know, God's Word and the power of the Holy Spirit gives us the same ability. As we draw near to God, He draws near to us, as we are told in the book of James. For you see, hearing the voice of God gives the people of God the confidence to live for Him. When we live for God, we gain new insights in Him. We come to have an increased understanding of our existence here on earth. And what on earth are we here for? We step into the favor of God. You see, God shows favor to the ones who delight in, connect with, and give honor to Him. And we're told that in Isaiah. You see, Christ alone holds the answers to the true meaning of life, because Christ is life. He is the unique source for the Christian life, and therefore no Christian needs anything that Christ has not provided. God promises to take care of all of our needs. You need nothing other than Christ to overcome any power of the universe. For in Him is nothing less than the fullness of God, and He is the head of every power and authority, for He created every power and authority. You see, since Christ, His death on the cross, His burial, His resurrection, and our acceptance of that through the rite of Christian baptism, we have entered into a covenant with Him, buried with Him in baptism. You see, a covenant of conviction and a covenant of obedience through the Holy Spirit. Circumcision is unique with the Jew when you're talking about circumcision of the flesh, but circumcision of the heart is not unique. It's available for anyone who comes to Christ. You see, Romans chapter 2, verse 29 says that no, a person is a Jew who is one inwardly. They're explaining who a Jew is. One who is a Jew inwardly, one who has been circumcised in the heart. No, a person is a Jew who is one inwardly, and circumcision is circumcision of the heart, by the Spirit, not by the written code. Such a person's praise is not from other people, but from God, Paul says in the book of Romans. And in Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 6, the Lord your God will circumcise your hearts and the hearts of your descendants so that you may love Him with all your heart and with all your soul and live. You see, Christ is sufficient. He's perfect. He's complete in His revelation of divine knowledge and in His embodiment of divine presence. Israel might forget many things as a people, but through the rite of circumcision, God would not permit His people to forget that they had entered into a covenant with Him. We, my friends, can have the same confidence that Christ is more than enough when we give our lives to Him. Only in Christ can we have that type of fullness. Apart from Him is only emptiness. And so again, we look at our text in verses 13 through 15. When you were dead in your sins and your uncircumcision of your sinful nature, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave us all our sins, having concealed the written code with its regulations that was against us and that stood opposed to us. He took it away, nailing it to the cross. And having disarmed the powers and authorities, He made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them. How? By the cross. You see, my friends, through the rite of baptism and the power of the Holy Spirit, we will not forget that we have entered into a covenant with God. 1 John chapter 4, beginning in verse 4, you, dear children, are from God and have overcome them, because the one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world. They are from the world and therefore speak from the viewpoint of the world, and the world listens to them. We are from God. And whoever knows God listens to us. But whoever is not from God does not listen to us. This is how we recognize the spirit of truth and the spirit of falsehood. Isaiah 66 and 2 says, "These are the ones that I look on with favor, those who are humble and contrite in spirit and who tremble at my word." Just like God's people of old, we are united by our dreams. We're united by our dreams. You know, Israel's tomorrows are filled with splendid things, land to be possessed, descendants as numerous as the stars, a kingdom to inherit, a place in the sun which would permit God's people to be a blessing to the whole world. No people could contemplate such lofty thoughts without being united in the process. You see, that's what unites us together as God's people. The glimmer of light on the far horizon, like a great beacon that beckoned Israel to come to a place of meaning and fulfillment. You see, God fulfills his promises. And that's what God's great nation, that's what his people learned, is that God was very faithful and he would fulfill his promises. You know, sometimes when we are disobedient and we tend to fail and to falter, we're tempted to believe that God will not fulfill his promises as a result. But you know, God has given us, as a Christian, a desire to repent and turn once again toward him. Just as he did the people of old, he gave them the promises of the Abrahamic covenant, and those would be fulfilled. You see, God is faithful when we are weary. God gives power to the weak. He promises to supply all of our needs. He gives a peace that passes all understanding. And my friends, we could go on and fill the pages with God's promises. God fulfills your dreams. In Psalm 103 and 5, the scripture says, talking about God, who satisfies your desires with good things, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. In John chapter 10, beginning in verse 27, "My sheep listen to my voice," Jesus said. "I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand, and I and the Father are one." You know, unity, which is built around such a promise, is sustained through fulfillment in Jesus Christ. My friends, even the darkness, even in the midst of darkness, there can be light. So we're united by our dreams and the fulfillment of promises, and what all is possible. God is able to do immeasurably more than all we could ever ask or imagine through the power that is alive within us. But we are also united by oppression. We're united by oppression. You know, for the Israelites, some of the things which were experienced in the progression from being a tribal clan to a mighty nation were difficult in the everyday. Like all of us who journey on God's good earth, Israel found life to be a mysterious mixture of happiness and of sorrow, of sunlight and shadow. You know, characteristically, human people of God wanted to put the label and blessings upon those experiences which had the touch of beauty upon them. We only wanted to label blessings as things that happened in our life that are just beautiful and wonderful. But God, however, often blessed his people in times of oppression, in times when things were pressing down upon us. How could I ever call this a blessing? But you know, the prophet declared that God would use oppression to purify his people. Turn with me, if you would, please, to Isaiah chapter 1. Isaiah chapter 1. It's about in the middle of the Bible. You'll find it right after Psalms and Proverbs. Isaiah chapter 1, let's take a look at verse 24 and following. Therefore, the Lord Almighty, the Mighty One of Israel, declares, "Ah, I will get relief from my foes and avenge myself on my enemies. I will turn my hand against you." Now, here he is talking about Jerusalem. "I will turn my hand against you," talking about his people. "I will thoroughly purge away your dross and remove all your impurities." So it's like, you know, being things that are not needed when you're sending metal through a fire, the dross. It's being burned away. And so God will turn his hand against us to thoroughly purge us from this stuff that's not needed, and to remove all of our impurities, the scripture goes on to say there in verse 25. But then in verse 26, he says, "I will restore your judges as in days of old, your counselors as at the beginning. Afterward, you will be called the city of righteousness, the faithful city." Verse 27, "Zion will be redeemed with justice, her penitent ones with righteousness." You see, sometimes God blesses us with difficult times. It was oppression which moved Israel out of Egypt on its way to the promised land. Israel, in a plethora of circumstances, was united by oppression so that destiny might not be lost. So we're united by oppression, but we're united by the law that was received as well. You know, a covenant had been enacted, blessed to be a blessing, all the way back in Genesis 12, 1 through 3. The memory of that covenant that we're talking about today, circumcision, had been written into Israel's flesh, Genesis chapter 17. In Egypt, the community had grown into an aggregate people large enough to be considered to be a threat to Egypt itself. Oppression had driven God's people out of Egypt. Israel, after crossing the Red Sea and on the way to its homeland, stood at the foot of Mount Sinai. Every incident, every circumstance in the lives of God's people, their past history, served to prepare them for this meaningful moment that was about to take place. The children of God could not have stood at this juncture, not even an hour before. It came in the fullness of time. Certainly, historical memories concerning a covenant made between God and Abraham did not fail that day as Israel stood at the foot of Mount Sinai. And he said, "I will bless you so that you will be a blessing. And by you, all the families of the earth will bless themselves." You see, molded by their history into a people in pursuit of a common purpose, the Israelites stood ready. And then God gave to his own one of the instruments through which they might become a blessing. Turn with me, if you would, please, to the second book of the Bible, Exodus chapter 20. Exodus chapter 20. Beginning in verse 1. Some of you know what you're going to find there. God spoke all of these words. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol in the form of anything in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the fathers to the third and the fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you nor your son or your daughter, nor your manservant or your maidservant, nor your animals, nor the alien within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, but he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day, and he made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, so that you may live long in the land of the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or his manservant or maidservant, his ox or his donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. Could the last commandment be written last? Do not covet. So that as we end and consider the reading of these commands, that maybe we can stop and speculate that when God commands us not to covet what we do not have, he's telling us that we truly need most always is him. That's what we need. And nothing else can truly satisfy us, no matter how good someone else's things look or how life looks to us. You know, A.W. Tozer says in his book, The Kingdom of the Holy, what comes into our minds when we think about God is the most important thing about us. Whatever we think about when God comes to mind is the most important thing about us. The Ten Commandments are still relevant 3,500 years after they were first given at Mount Sinai. The major function of the Ten Commandments is to reveal who God is. They reveal who God is. Who someone is can best be understood by knowing what matters most to him. Tozer goes on to say, obeying these commands from God or not is always a matter of response to who he is more than a matter of morality. The Ten Commandments tell us more about who he really is and how he wants our lives to change by knowing him. End of quote. You see, the possession of a law so unique as God had given his people, so majestic and so authoritative, and the dramatic evidence that God was so faithful to his promises of old, all of those things were used to unite Israel in a very powerful way. Unified by circumcision, unified by separation, by dreams, by oppression, and by the possession of the unique law, Israel moved forward toward the realization of that destiny to be a blessing. Now, I just want to throw a couple things out here as far as separation is concerned. Maybe it's separating for your quiet time each and every day. Maybe it's separating for a time of worship. Maybe it's separating for a life group during the week. Wherever we can find encouragement and strength in the word of our Lord. You know, unified by all of that, my friends, the same is true for you and me. When we accept Christ through the rite of baptism, when we separate ourselves for, again, the quiet times, opportunities to be with him and his people, we dream. We dream those lofty thoughts of having experienced his kingdom while here on earth. His promise to never leave us or forsake us. We find ourselves in His favor. And even in the difficult times, we know that He is faithful to see us through. We open ourselves to His work in us, sanctifying, making us holy. My friends, as we draw on His power through the Holy Spirit to follow Jesus' commands, to love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind and all your strength, and then to love your neighbor as yourself, we are then blessed to be a blessing. You know, in the beautiful words of the old hymn, we're marching to Zion. Beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. That, my friends, is our eternal destiny. God moves us forward each and every day. And what we are to do is offer our bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to Him. It all begins in a relationship with Jesus Christ. I'd like to ask the praise team to begin to make their way forward. If you're here today, you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you've never practiced that rite of baptism where you receive a gift of the Holy Spirit, your sins are forgiven, I want to invite you to come today and to do just that, to be baptized into Him. That's where it all begins. That's where the journey begins. And you know, maybe you've been on that journey for a long time, but you find yourself kind of backsliding a little bit. But you know you need to repent and make that turn back towards God and start living for Him again. And maybe you just need to recommit yourself this morning. Perhaps you're worshiping with us and you have for some time, you're already